Hello everyone, Ziyos on this side. Today we'll be dealing with division angiosperm. We'll be dealing about like how they are highly evolved plants. They are the proper terrestrial plants, and we'll be dealing about the alternation of generation in between them, about their sporophyte phase and the gametophyte phase. Okay, now we'll be dealing about their microspores and the megaspores as well. That is what we call as a pollen or the male spores, and like megaspore, that is called as a female spore. We'll be dealing about like the different types of the whorls in them, like the two different types of whorls, that is called as the essential whorls and the accessory whorls. We'll be dealing about the androecium, the gynoecium, and the sepals, petals, calyx, and the corolla, that is like the same thing. We'll be dealing about two different classes as well, that is called as the dicotyledons and the monocotyledons. So let's get started. Okay, we are dealing with the division angiosperm. Here we do know that the most highly evolved plants are none other than the members of angiosperm. They are pure terrestrial plants. And you should be knowing about like the alternation of generation is found in the angiosperms as well. We do know about the alternation of generation, that they'll be dealing with the sporophyte phase and the gametophyte phase both. So here again going for, they are showing heteromorphic, which means they'll be showing two different forms, like the different forms, and that is what we call as the sporophyte form and the gametophytic form. We have dealt with this beforehand as well, but still again I'm giving you. The sporophyte phase of the angiosperm is diploid, dominant, autotrophic, and independent, regardless of the gametophyte. Again repeating, that the sporophyte phase of the angiosperm is diploid, which will be having the double number of the chromosomes. It will be autotrophic and dominant. And one extra thing is independent, which means it is not dependent at all on the gametophyte. Whereas if I will be dealing with a gametophyte, that is haploid one, that is even reduced and it is concealed one. Deal with these cases, that the sporophyte phase is the dominant phase in the life of the angiosperm plants, whereas the gametophytic phase is the recessive phase in the life of the angiospermic plants. If I'll be dealing with the male and the female parts, that is called as the megaspores and the microspores. These are the spores, the male spore and the female spore. So we'll be dealing with the first one called as a microspore. We also call them as a pollen. The pollens are called as the male spores, and they are formed in the microsporangia. They are formed in the microsporangia, which is also called as anther. Please do remember as well that the pollen is formed in the microsporangia, and that is also called as microsporangia, is also called as anther. And this microsporangia is present in the male part of the flower called as stamen. Done? Okay. If I'll be dealing with a female spore, that is called as the megaspore. That is formed in the megasporangia. I'm repeating that the female part is formed in the megasporangia, and it is also called as ovule. It is also called as ovule. This ovule after fertilization will be called as seed. Very good. Now this ovule or the megasporangia is formed in the carpel. Deal with the case. Now we should be knowing that the most highly evolved plants will be having the proper flower as well. And here they have two different types of whorls in them. They are called as the essential whorls and the accessory whorls. We should be knowing about the word essential, which means they are the compulsory whorls in the flower. If they are present, then only the flower will be going for the proper reproduction process. And if they are absent, the flower will not be able to go for the proper reproduction, or it will not be able to reproduce itself. So the essential whorls, which are compulsory, they are the male part called as the androecium, and the female part, that is called as the gynoecium. Again, I am repeating that the essential whorls are compulsory for the reproduction of the plant. They are called as the male part as androecium and the female part as gynoecium. Now, if I will be dealing with the accessory whorls, here accessory whorls, we do have two different types of valves in the accessory valves category as well. They're called as a calyx and corolla. Calyx and the corolla, or we call them in that normal language, we call them as a sepals and petals. Again, sepals is nothing but the calyx and petals is nothing but the corolla. There are some specialized modified plants as well which do not have the proper calyx and the proper corolla, or rather I should call as the sepals and the petals. Rather, they have some diffused calyx and the corolla, and they will be called as tepals. Deal with that case as well. Okay, if I'll be dealing with the division angiosperm, that is divided into two classes called as the dicotyledons and the monocotyledons. As the word suggests itself, that the dicotyledon will be having two cotyledons, or like two cotyledons in the embryo, whereas the monocotyledon will be having only single cotyledon in the embryo. I repeat, the word di itself says that there will be two cotyledons in the embryo, whereas the mono will be having only single cotyledon in the embryo. Okay, if I'll be dealing with the root system, first thing you should be knowing about, like, which one is like the more advanced one. So we'll be dealing with the cases. We should check first like the difference, and then we'll be going on to the conclusion. The root system in the dicotyledon is a tap root system. As we have discussed earlier, again I'm giving you, there are two types of the root system in the plant kingdom. That's called as a tap root system or the adventitious root system. If the root is straight, that is called as a tap root system, and if the root is branched, something like that, that will be called as the adventitious root system. So here you are having taproot system, plus the stem of the dicotyledon plants are branched, like they will be having some like branches in them. A lot of branches are seen in the dicotyledon plants. And vice versa, if I'll be dealing with the monocotyledons, they have adventitious roots. They have adventitious roots, which means like their roots will be branched. Their roots will be branched, but their stem will be rarely branched. Their stem will be rarely branched, which means that majority of the members of the class monocotyledon stems will not be branched, but their roots will be. And here the roots are not branched, but the stem is. Okay, the second thing is about leaves. So the leaves of the dicotyledon class show reticulate venation. Show reticulate venation. Now if I'll be drawing a leaf here, okay, let's see, like this is a leaf for me. So if you will be observing something like this type of venation, this is nothing but the reticulate venation, and this is the special characteristic of dicotyledon class. And if I'm dealing here leaves, they are saying that the parallel venation. So if I'm drawing a leaf here, something like this, and I'm drawing like the venations like this, this will be called as a parallel venation. So the parallel venations are seen in the monocotyledon plants, whereas the reticulate venations are seen in the dicotyledon plants. Okay, go for. Now the third thing is called as the flower. Here in case of the dicotyledons, they are saying that the flowers show tetramerous either or pentamerous symmetry. First thing you should be knowing about, what is the tetra, what is the penta. Hopefully you do know about like the mono, dihedra, tetra, penta, hexa, hepta, octa, nona, deca. So here they are saying about the tetramerous or the pentamerous symmetry in the flower will be. So if the flower is showing like the tetramerous symmetry, what does it mean? So you can literally cut the flower into four identical pieces will be tetramerous. And if you are able to go for like the five different identical pieces, that will be pentamerous. So if the flower can be differentiated, it can be cut into five different or the four different identical pieces, that will be in the dicotyledon. That will be belonging to the dicotyledon. But if the flower is only able to be cut in the tetramerous, if the flower is only able to be cut in the trimerous, that is the monocotyledon, which means like the flower will be something like this. So you can cut it into 1, 2, and 3 pieces only. Now the last difference from our side about the cambium. So we do know about these things as well about the cambium, that if the cambium is present, if the cambium is present in between the xylem and the phloem, there will be secondary growth. And if the cambium is absent, there will be no secondary growth at all. We do know about the secondary growth is increasing the girth of the stem. Increasing the girth of the stem is called as secondary growth, and increasing the height is called as the primary growth. Deal with. So here we do know in the dicotyledons that the cambium is present. The cambium is present between the xylem and the phloem, so ultimately it will be showing you the secondary growth. But in case of the monocotyledons, the cambium is absent at all. And if the cambium is absent, there will be no secondary growth observed at all. Done. In case of the dicotyledon, secondary growth is present. Why? Because of the cambial rings are present. But in case of the monocotyledon, there is no cambial rings, so ultimately though no secondary growth will be. Examples. If I'll be dealing with the dicotyledon examples, one of the most famous example will be none other than sunflower, or what we call as the Helianthus annuus. Like the pea, hopefully like you have gone through this pea plant in the genetics studies. That is what we call as a Picum sativum. We do have bean as well, we have Rosa indica as well, that is called as rose. These all are there in the dicotyledon. And if I am dealing with the monocotyledon, yes, it's Z maize, that is called as a maize, or the bamboo, or the banana. These all fall under the category of the monocotyledons. You should be going for the examples as well. If you are preparing for the competitive exams, you should be knowing about the examples of the dicotyledon as well and the monocotyledon as well. Okay. Hopefully this lecture series is beneficial for you guys. Thank you.